Are we really ready to talk about sex? Let's do it. Sex is a biological phenomenon. Only living things can have sex, but not all living things do. Sex, or better said, sexual reproduction, evolved out of the necessity to adapt to their environment. Before sex, living things would reproduce by cloning or budding themselves to create a mostly identical replica of the parent organism. This is a low biological cost solution, relatively speaking, since organisms with the genetic material that is best adapted to their particular environment would be the ones that reproduce the most, guaranteeing in a way the success and the permanence of that genetic material through time. Think of bacteria. If nothing changes in their environment, there's no need to adapt to anything. So they keep their DNA mostly untouched and unchanged from one clone to the other. Mutations do exist, but they are in their vast majority useless, and since there's no advantage to have them, they just don't keep them. However, ecological niches can go under stress or changes, and organisms need to be prepared for whatever it might happen. A mental experiment might help us to visualize it better.
Let's say we have a colony of organisms that need potassium to subsist and thrive and are extremely allergic to sodium, and that they reproduce by cloning. Let's say as well that they live on a rocky surface with plenty of potassium and no trace of sodium to be seen. So they grow and succeed until one day a big flood of seawater comes in and deposits a lot of sodium all around, killing many. Some organisms will survive out of luck. Others, because maybe they have a random advantage that allows them to filter the sodium out and keep eating the potassium. Others, because they are able to eat the sodium without dying. In any case, a large, very large number of our original population will be gone.
Now, they cannot know when or if that catastrophe will happen again, but if it does, the lucky ones who survived the first wave might not be that lucky next time.
It would be great if somehow they too could get that trait, so they can have a better fighting chance next time a surge of sodium comes in. But since they only reproduce by cloning, the only way to get it is either by a lucky error when transcribing your DNA into a new clone, or if one of the ones who already have the adaptation somehow gives it to you.
And this is why sex evolved, to give offspring a better chance of survival by combining the relatively successful genetic material of two existing parents. And I say relatively because, in the most basic of senses, an organism is biologically successful if it reproduces and survives, not if it's the best. Nature cares very little about superlatives. Now, the evolutionary process of sexual reproduction, though, is way too long and complex, and totally out of the scope of this video, because I do want to focus most of my attention and the time that we will be spending on this video to human sexual, to human issues, human sex, and human sexuality. So I recommend you to watch the video from "It's Okay to Be Smart" about the subject, about the evolution of sex, but to give you the shortest of summaries. Prokaryotes, meaning bacteria and archaea, can sometimes exchange genetic material between individuals in a discrete manner. We call this horizontal gene transfer. But it's not real sex. First of all, because there's a tiny amount of genetic material that is being transferred between individuals. Second, because the intention is not to produce an offspring in the moment, but just to exchange information. But they do exchange genetic material. And in fact, that's how resistances and evolution in bacteria and archaea happens. Well, it's one of the mechanisms through which it happens. Now, the steps between this and real sex, the origin of sex, or even what will constitute that origin, is still hotly debated and is hot ongoing research. But what we can say is that when eukaryotes like us evolved, sex evolved with them. And in fact, maybe we eukaryotes exist because of sex. It is a large evolutionary step to go from organisms with no nucleus and free-floating genetic material to a complex cell with DNA highly organized into chromosomes and bearing a nucleus with two copies of each of them to be shuffled every time they reproduce. You know, it's kind of a stretch to say that from A to B is an easy road. Now, it is thought that sex first appeared and happened between two isogamic organisms. Isogamic meaning two beings, two living things that show no apparent or visible differences between them, but that can sexually reproduce because they have a sexual charge that is compatible or complementary to the others in the same species. Sounds complicated, but it's really not. Paramecia, for example, are single-celled individuals who have sex. But when we look at them, we don't see anything particularly male or female about any paramecium. And that is because they are isogamic, so they have isogamic sex. Now, these particular genetic charges that they have and that are complementary with one another are very easily reduced to the binary case of plus and minus, positive and negative, male and female. But the reality is that we have found that in several species, especially in fungi, there can be up to 10 different sexual charges that play among each other to have sexual relations. Fungi in particular, they have one of the most complex and bizarre reproductive systems that I know of. Fungi are weird and awesome, so give them some respect. Now, it is thought that it is from here, isogamic sex, that anisogamic sex evolved, meaning sex between organisms that differentiate sexually. Why? We don't know. In fact, from an evolutionary point of view, sex doesn't make much sense. I mean, to have sex means to find two viable, available, compatible, and complementary individuals to produce only one. And even worse, in anisogamic sex, only half of the population is able to produce that offspring. The other half has the role reduced to simple fertilization. Oh, but it doesn't stop there. Anisogamic sex kept evolving, meaning the differentiation, the gap between two sexes kept widening all the way until we got where we are as human beings. Because we don't practice isogamic sex, we practice a very, very particular kind of anisogamic sex, which is called oogamic sex. And that refers to the massive differences between our sexual interactive cells, or gametes, which means one of them needs a tremendous investment of energy and resources to be produced, while the other is mass-produced and it's incredibly cheap to make. If human eggs are made of biological gold, then sperm is the cheapest of plastics, basically. Do you see now why we need to understand the basics in order to explain the complexity above? The sexual dimorphism? The sexual differences that we see in humans evolved as a trait attached to a particular sexual capacity, meaning some people can fertilize, some people can get fertilized, and they have attached a series of physical characteristics that evolved along with that capacity. And in fact, the way that this separation of sexes develops in the womb gives us hints of how we evolved and how we got to where we are as a species. Did you know that all humans, when we are conceived, have a feminine body? All of us. This is regardless of our genetic charge or chromosomes, whatever. Human zygotes are all female. The masculinization of the body happens inside the womb when the fetus gets to a certain point in their development. But before that, we have absolutely the whole framework and the whole infrastructure to reproduce and to be fertilized. All male individuals are conceived with the capacity to develop breasts, to develop uterus, to develop eggs. This is strongly correlated throughout all the animal kingdom, especially mammal, meaning not only sexual reproduction is the main, if not the only, mechanism for reproduction. Also, that is the female, the one who has to invest practically all of its energy and resources to produce such offspring. It makes sense then, from a biological point of view, that bodies are conceived in a way that is easier to take away functions than having to add them from scratch. And it also means that some of those processes can be stopped or reversed somewhere in the middle. And this is incredibly important to understand, because we all grow up with the idea that chromosomes dictate our sexual characteristics, but the more we study, the more we find that the story is not that simple. But yes, chromosomes, the volumes where all our DNA is organized into, do play a central role determining the sexual characteristics of an individual. We humans have a total of 46 chromosomes, from which only 2 are sexually charged, are sexually differentiated. I think you all guys know how they call X and Y. In humans who have a double X chromosome, the development of the fetus carries on normally inside the womb, and the resulting baby will have the native capacity to produce offspring, because we'll have the native capacity to be fertilized. Those who have a combination of the two, X and Y, will go through a masculinization process inside of the womb that will build the same basic reproductive structure and then take off and or turn off and or radically diminish the most of their functionalities, turning the individual basically into a factory of gametes, and they're only capable of producing offspring when they can fertilize somebody else. This is why a good friend of mine always says that he feels traumatized to know that somewhere inside of his body, inside of his belly, there's probably an atrophiated uterus. But back to the point. These two cases, XX and XY, resume the vast majority of human sexual capacities and morphologies, but, as we have said before, there can be combinations in between and beyond. Some people, for example, regardless of their chromosomic charge, will have a feminized body with the internal structure of a masculinized one, or vice versa. Some people will even have both structures at the same time, mixed to different levels. This is what we call intersex. And then some will have more than 2 sexual chromosomes, sometimes 3, sometimes 4, up to 6 even. This is why we need to stop thinking about biological sex as a binary system, but to think of it as a spectrum. In fact, if we make a survey of all of the variables that we need to take into account to describe the sex, the biological sex of an individual, and plug them all together throughout a whole population, what we will see is a bipolar spectrum, nothing to do with the mental condition, but a spectrum with 2 poles concentrating most of the cases, most of the individuals, but with some people in the middle and some people to the sides. We have all kinds of labels for each of these groupings of people. But what I want you to understand is that these biological names don't carry through any meaning besides of their strict biological definition. We can call, for example, some people biological males, and that will mean that's all they are. People with the capacity to fertilize other people. The same goes for biological females. Biological females are people with the capacity to be fertilized and to carry offspring. This doesn't say anything about the way these people should look, should behave, should act. What? Nothing at all. In fact, many species that have oogamic sex, like us, don't show any differences between fertilizers and carriers. Look at cats! Unless you have a decent knowledge of cat anatomy, it is absolutely normal to not know if a cat is a male or a female. I mean, you just saw my cat. Is it a male or a female? This is why we need to stop extrapolating our biological functionalities to our societal functionalities. Society and social norms are created to handle biological functions, not the other way around. What I mean is, there's nothing in our biology that says males need to dominate anyone, or that females should stay at home and raise children. We didn't evolve to do that. We are the ones who decided that's how we wanted to control our biological reality. We are the ones who got lazy and wanted everything to be simple, black and white, positive and negative. A binary world. Divide and conquer, they said. Right? Now, on the next video, we're gonna talk about the next layer of complexity in this journey of understanding human identity. How does sexuality and sexual attraction work from a scientific point of view? I hope to see you then.